via satellite to New York and comments from Cactus Jack.
Well, I guess the last you left Cactus Jack, you described it as a catatonic state. And certainly there's been a lot of questions for my actions. And I understand, because you never met Uncle Willie. And at this point, Tommy Dreamer, I can sense you looking at my arm, wondering what happened to Cactus Jack. And yes, there's been rumors circulating around. And well, Tommy, this is what happened to Cactus Jack. This is what happened, and this is the result, but it's really not that big a deal. Because the doctors have assured me that on second-degree burns, there will be some discoloration for some time, but really no permanent scarring. Which is more than I can say for my opponent, Terry Funk, who weaseled his way out in an ambulance, screaming and crying like a little baby with his third-degree burns. And the irony did not escape me that the man who stepped into the ECW arena with a branding iron and sizzled his name on my chest is the one who walked away with the permanent scars. And that one match signified to me that I was, in Japan, the king of the death match, which I guess in ECW would make me the king of the hardcore. Because my Uncle Willie knew all about Japan. You see, Tommy Dreamer, you never met my Uncle Willie. Neither did I, because he's been dead for 50 years. But I always felt like I knew him because there was a big picture of my Uncle Willie at 18 years old, ready to save the world, hanging up in the hallway of my home in East Setauket. And every day I'd see my dad almost get down and genuflect in front of that picture. Almost like you used to do in front of my picture, Tommy Dreamer. Because Uncle Willie was a hero. You see, Uncle Willie was on the boat that brought the bomb over to Japan to save the day for the good guys. Now, what happened to that boat after it delivered the bomb is a well-known story, and although they never saw or found Uncle Willie's body, we've all got a pretty good idea of what happened. But we rest assured that my Uncle Willie died a hero. That is, until I made my way to Japan, to Hiroshima, and saw generations later, walking in the Peace Park, the pictures of people with flesh burning down their arms, the flesh hanging off their bones. Let's hear it for the bombing of innocent children. USA! USA! Let's hear it for the bombing of helpless women! Willie! Willie! You see, all my life I saw people whose idea of suffering was to kick back on that last six-pack until the next welfare check came in. And they said, we bombed those sniff bastards! They were human beings, you sons of bitches! And you killed them. I went back to my dad and I said, Dad, I hope that Uncle Willie died a painful death. I hope they ate him good. I hope they swallowed his spine if he even had one. That baby killer! For the first time since the infamous 1968 Parsonage Road spanking, my dad hit me. And he said, take a look at yourself, son. Take a look at the scars. Take a look at the burns. And take a look at the missing body parts and find out that the same thing that makes those Japanese wrestlers so tough is the same reason that we had to sacrifice 130,000 human lives. Because they keep going and going and going. And the only way to save millions of more lives was by a show of force. And I said, Dad, by whose authority do you believe in the following words you just spoke? And he said, the government of the United States. The government of the United States. And I believed his words. And I looked at that dollar bill and saw that the father of our country was a slave-holding, wig-wearing, wooden-tooth-wearing bastard. And so it's very simple, Tommy Dreamer. If we can sacrifice 130,000 human lives in the goal of a higher purpose, then really the DDT of your head on the mat is pretty damn insignificant news. And if you can trust the government that mutilates babies, then I ought to get the benefit of the doubt. Because I and Raven have a higher purpose. And that thought brings me peace.